Thank you for joining us on Worldwide Slot Car Chat number 112. I'm your host, Greg Galb. Great gang of people going again. Tony, Don, Leo, John, Luff, Chuck, Big Den, Alan, Mike, Garth, Jim, Dev, Wayne. Oh, Wayne is here. Awesome. So he'll be here to hear Mike's findings and Frank and other people. And as always, we're going to talk about slot cars. And as always, just because we talk about slot cars that you don't play with doesn't mean that you're not welcome on this chat. So come and join us and share your passion of whatever kind of slot car that you enjoy. Just do a quick Google search of Worldwide Slot Car Chat on Zoom and ignore the video results. Go to the forums and you'll find the link to join us every Wednesday. We alternate between an early show and a late show. So if you keep looking and you find a time that you cannot attend, look again the next week, because it might be a time that you can attend. And just kind of as a humorous thing, I only just realized that on the worldwide time zone thing that I usually include a link to, just below the list of time zones, there's a little scroll bar, a horizontal scroll thing that you can drag. And as you drag it, you can see little smiley faces or frowny faces next to the times to indicate whether or not that's a likely good time or bad time for the people in that time zone. And because the world takes 24 hours to go around, there is literally no single time that there are all happy faces or even happy and medium faces. There is always at least one sad face. So you're welcome to hit that link and scroll that thing sideways until the cows come home. Let me know if you find a single minute that does not have one frowny face on that list. And I'll change the time of this chat to that, and we'll see what happens. Anyway, we always start off with show and tell. So if you have something that you want to show and or tell, please raise your virtual hand. And when I call for people when I do the last call for show and tell, wave frantically and maybe me or John will catch you. John, did you see any new faces or names that I need to pay attention to? I don't see any just yet. So if you are new to the chat, you can raise your virtual hand and I'll call on you and you can introduce yourself. But to everybody out there who's never been on a chat, if you want to attend live, you are not required to turn on your camera. You are not required to turn on your microphone. You are not required to participate in any way, shape, or form. But there's this nifty little chat thing down on, you know, whatever side you're seeing. There's a chat thing in here. And you can type a question. So you don't have to ask it. You don't have to show your face. You can just type a question. And if, you know, somebody will see that question and either answer it via the chat or will answer it by talking about it. So don't be afraid to come on and join and get some questions answered. If we can't answer it, I'll be really surprised. First, I'll be really surprised. And then we'll go find the answer for you. All right. So I've talked enough. Tony P is on my list of people to show and tell. Hit us up, Mr. Petrucci.
Hey, man. These arrived the other today or a couple of days ago from Top Slots.
Turn a little so there's not so much glare. Cool.
See it okay?
No.
There we go. Hold it right there. The
topples, but that's the Moby Dick one, right? The long tail.
£20.
Oh, not bad.
What are you getting £20 for those for? Where are you getting that?
BMW M1.
Top slots.
Sorry.
Wow, that's really good.
Top slots.
He hasn't got nothing left, but the looks of it, it's all gone.
Well, you bought them all.
No, I missed out on the deal.
They had a Queen's Jubilee special weekend.
Ah, okay. Those are some good specials then.
I wonder how many the Queen got.
I actually love those Fly GB Trek Lancias. A little bit of work, they actually go pretty well.
We see what you see, Petrucci. So if you can't see it through the glare, then neither can
it's
we.
It's a Nissan.
Going through his stack. He's got a big old stack here. Ah.
Hey, that slot, Audi.
Tilt it down a little bit. Hold it up and tilt it down. There you go.
19 pounds.
Jesus.
The Avant slots are nice. Those Audis, the bodywork is just amazing.
There was three of them there, so I bought them.
Piling it up.
Every Audi ever built.
There we go. I missed out on the good deals because my internet went down and my phone went down. All the good stuff like the NSRs and all that that was going cheap.
Sideways and Avant slot aren't good stuff. You got good deals. That's like that endless suitcase full of cars that.
I've been trying to phone him. I can't even get him on the phone.
Tony, that's fantastic because it's not what you spend, it's what you save.
Yeah.
It is, yeah.
Saved hundreds of pounds.
Certainly did.
Right. And the more you spend, the more you save.
Exactly. Thanks for sharing, Tony. And next up you got anything else?
No, that's it for me.
All right. Thanks for sharing. And Dennis, you are next, sir. Take it away.
Okay. Just let me change my camera over so you can get a picture. We had a swap meet at Electric Dreams this weekend, right? And as part of the swap meet, I was selling off some of my own old stuff, and I got hold of the remains of that friend of mine, Jay Henry, the collection that I sold most of last year. And when his son brought it to me, he brought me this car, which was a car that I actually built for Jay that I really wanted to have. And last year when he brought me all the cars, it wasn't part of the stuff that he brought because it was in a separate box. It still was in the box in which I mailed the car to Jay.
Oh, wow.
And literally like 2 weeks before he passed. So he never actually got a chance to drive it. But now it's back with its creator, and I'm super, super happy about that. So that was that. I just wanted to share. And then I see John Underwood on the call today. John. There you go. It's on the jig.
Ooh, what you making?
Excellent. I think it's missing a few parts.
It's missing a few parts, but one of the parts is already underneath the body. That piece of brass that actually screws into the front mounting holes is how I'm going to mount the body, and that piece of brass will be located inside the rails of the chassis in such a way that it has a little bit of movement and rattle. And then at the back of the chassis on that piece of wire around the back here, there will be another little bracket that will fit into the rear hole of the body. And then unfortunately, of course, most of the driver and all of that is going to have to be brutalized to make way for the motor. So he's going to end up like, head and shoulders and top half of a steering wheel in a puddle of oil.
Yeah, I'll just call him Dave.
Anyway, John. It's on the go. Thank you for your patience. And
no, that's fine, mate.
It'll be done soon.
September, I think. It's got two races.
Okay. So. Yep. It'll be done soon. And then the good news for Greg is your 935 Porsche is up next.
Woo-hoo!
It's just a standard scale electric one, Frank.
That's a standard scale electric 250F, right? The Maserati.
I thought I recognized it, but I wasn't sure.
Fangio one, yeah. And so far, I haven't attacked the body with a Dremel or anything yet, but I will. It's going to need a little bit of cutout up front where the guide fits. It's going to need, as I said, most of the interior and the driver removed, but that's about it.
No, that's all fine, mate. Should I? Hey,
that's very nice. That's it for me today.
Good stuff. Any other questions for Dennis? All righty, let's move on. Next on my list is Mr. Young. Take it away, Don.
We can see his ear.
Sorry, I accidentally muted you.
Way to go, Greg.
I'm such a
there he is.
For a while, and finally picked one up.
Very nice.
Nice.
We call those the scooper birds because when we raced them digitally, they basically would just scoop each other up off the track.
Well, this one is already digital, and I basically got it cheaper than what they wanted for the Evolution one, so
nice.
I couldn't pass it up.
Pretty, pretty, pretty.
Very cool.
Then I don't know if any of you ever messed with any of the old Eldon cars.
That harkens back to my youth, the poorly scaled Eldon Lotus
23.
I've been playing with Eldons for a spell, but I got a box of bodies. There was 10 of them in there. And what was amazing was they had the lights and the windshields on them, which is
amazing. Yeah, that's the 96 Ferrari.
Never find.
Makes quite a nice little car if you can find a driver that's under 9 feet tall.
Yeah, well, it's like 1/20th drivers in 1/32nd cars.
But yeah.
No, the drivers just have gigantism. That's all.
Yeah.
But anyway, for $3 a piece, I couldn't pass them up.
Yeah. Well, a bit of work on a brass chassis under them. They look pretty good and go pretty well.
Yep, that's future plans, along with a lot of others.
Nice find.
That's all I got.
All right, thanks for sharing, Don. And next up, I believe, Mr. Sisto. Take it away, Frank.
Hello there. I just wanted to show this. It's been on Facebook, but not everybody's on Facebook. This is a Strange Brew modified body and motor, and my take on a modified.
That's nice.
Thank you.
and you scratch built the chassis?
Yep.
Excellent.
Is that going in a proxy?
Yes. Harry Weiss does a couple of proxies a year. This year, the July one got canceled, and he's moving it to January of next year. So this will wait until then to go to Missouri for his proxy on the oval track.
So do you have a sheet of lead just wrapped around the motor?
No, it's just on the bottom, but stuck to the motor. Without weight, they are so light, the rear wheels basically spin all the way down the straightaway.
It looks like it's formed a little bit to the motor or something.
Yes, okay. Exactly. Put two-sided tape under it, and that actually will go around the track. It's this particular chassis, a bit fiddly to build. I actually attempted to copy one of Strange Brew Dave's chassis that he had pictures of online. But it's kind of neat the way that the motors are in there.
That's an engine, not a motor. The motor's further back in the car.
Yeah, you're right. That's an engine.
Oh, Frank, I love the engine detail. It's awesome.
Yeah, it's nice. Love it.
And I know some of you should be able to guess what the pipes are made from.
It looks like wire.
Shrink wrap?
Who? What?
Shrink wrap tube?
No.
Nope.
Okay. Anybody else want to guess?
Styrene tubing? Or no. Solder, maybe.
There you go. Dennis got it.
Oh, actual solder.
It's pieces of solder that are just stuck into a brass tube, and brass tube is painted flat black.
That's awesome.
So it was really fun building, although this one is a bit fiddly. My next one will probably not have a wire chassis. It'll probably be a brass tube chassis, square tube. And then I'm only having to really form the nurse, and that's about it, because this one took forever, over 2 weeks of hit and miss working on it.
Hey, Frank.
Really good, though. Well,
thank you. It was fun building.
Is it 1/24th or 32nd?
Oh, no, this is 1/32nd. My hands are that big, Dennis.
What were you going to ask, Brian?
Huh?
I think I heard Brian about to ask a question.
I had a question.
Okay.
Go ahead, Jim.
Is that the solder for the headers an attempt to get some unfair advantage with ballast?
A couple of extra grams don't hurt.
That's right. It doesn't. Actually, there's no weight restrictions or anything on this. And it's on a wood routed track, so there's no need for magnets, luckily. Anyway, but yeah, and what couple of kind of like is that it has to have a roll bar, and it's supposed to have a dashboard, and it's really hard to I don't know if I can even see it. There's a white dot on the back of the of the firewall. That's my dashboard.
Yeah, we can see it. We can see it.
Oh, yeah. Good. Yeah, it is in there. So hopefully Harry can see it when he gets it.
There you go.
Awesome. That's it.
What wheels were those?
These are CB Design modified wheels.
Okay.
And then it was really the Hoosier decals on the tires. I'm just amazed how they don't go on and look that good when they first go on, but once they dry.
And whose decals were those?
Oh, Teresa Wolf, I think. Is somebody on eBay is where I got them. I got a set of 1/24th because I do 1/25th. There's a 1/25th class for Harry too, but and they when they go on, they just look huge, but once they dry up and shrink a little bit, and
they look great.
Cover the future.
And those are 4-gauge tires all around?
Yes.
Okay.
Whole gauge. Softer in the rear, harder in the front, of course. Try to get some advantage back there if I can.
That's one of the few times that shrinkage is good.
Yeah. Exactly. Right. Well, we'll see how it does in January. I think three things they look at. Two I know for sure, which is they do a lap, and so they compare each other for speed. But they also it's really mainly for modeling skills and to get people building brass chassis. Although these are really simple chassis, you'll never see Dennis make anything like this, because because of the flop.
Yes, you will. Simple. I built lots of simple chassis.
Do you? Okay.
Yeah, that one that I just showed you for John, that's a super simple chassis.
Well, for you. Maybe not for the rest of us.
It's all about the application and what it needs to be. Yeah.
And that's what Harry Weiss and Strange Brew Dave and Area 51, I don't see George here today yet, but it's basically just to promote scratch building, modeling, and having fun.
Yeah, George has been doing a whole series on from the start on doing his chassis and his body and
painting
and modeling. Yeah, that's good.
Yep, he is.
Yeah, good stuff. All right, any other questions or comments for Frank?
What I like about George is that he's not an expert like Dennis, and he admits it. And when he's doing something, I can fix that later. Don't worry about it. I love it when he's just so down to earth and it's like me on the workbench, you know. I screwed that up. We'll do it again. And that's what he does. And he does it on camera, so it's great.
Yeah, you haven't sat and listened to me when I'm working. I mean, I screw up plenty. So don't think that that's anything reserved just for you.
I know.
Yeah. Go ahead, Big Den.
One of his late gaining videos, he had a complete screw up and it said, ended up being a complete win, even though it didn't turn out anything like he wanted it.
Right.
And that's why you need to not worry about that kind of stuff.
Exactly.
Big Dan had a question.
Yeah, Frank, just a word of caution. Make sure that your engine doesn't overheat or your solder in pipes might disappear.
That's right. They'll just melt right away.
I'll be amazed if he can manage to get his engine to overheat on that car.
I'll try.
All right. Thank you, sir. And next up is Mr. Rose. Go ahead, Jim.
Well, I bought a new slot car the other day, and it's a slot car that I've never had before. And we're trying to find something new for the Motown group to run. And a friend of mine being a professional Alfa / Fiat / Ferrari / anything Italian mechanic, why don't we run these? So we're looking at running the NSR Fiat Abarth 500 Challenge Cup. And I bought one, never had one before. I think they're kind of cool looking. They do have some quirks to them. One is it's got this big long guide, which I guess is a rally type guide out of something else. So it has just a little bit of travel to it. The other is there is no rear screws for the body. The body clips in like that. You see the clip there and the hole in the back of the trunk area clips in there, and then you secure the front two screws. So a couple little quirks to the car. I like the looks of it, but it came with standard spoke wheels, and in this particular car came with black ones. So my local hobby shop happened to have the BBS inserts. So I got the BBS inserts, which were white, painted them red, put a little black in the center, clear coated them. And I think car looks much better, and it sets up that livery car off really well. So
much better.
I added bling. I didn't add performance. I added bling. Well, okay. I did add performance. There's a close up of the wheels. And as performance wise, these things are short and tall. Hence, there's a lot of lead in it. There's about each one of those sheets of pieces of lead is probably about 2 grams or so. And then each of those buttons are 4 grams of tungsten. Those are not the magnets. So I've got 2 4-gram tungsten buttons and then an additional 2 grams on each side and about probably right around 2 grams in the front. Now the car slides very nicely. It doesn't get super tippy, even on a sticky track. So I think it's going to be a fun class. So if anybody's going to come up to Modesto next month, we're going to have the Motown NSR Abarth Challenge.
NSR Abarth 500 Challenge.
Abarth 500 Challenge.
Yeah.
What this is, it's going to be a drag race style elimination. So there's going to be 16 drivers. If we have more than 16, we'll figure out how to pare it down to 16, but it's going to be head to head. So qualifier one races qualifier 16, and it's 3 laps crash and burn. And winner moves on, loser goes home. Cars will be supplied. So it's going to be a semi IROC class. And to get a feel for if people like these. So I'm trying to make some fun there at Motown as well as have serious racing. So I think this will do the job for that. And 2 or 3 people already have them. Quite a few more have expressed interest in them, and they're kind of cool. If we run them, we'll run them pretty much dead stock, just with tuning. The tires work fine. Just add lead and put it in the slot and run it. So that's coming up next month. And that's the end.
Well, hopefully if they crash, they don't go home. They just go back to their pit. But
What I'm hoping for is that when they crash, people are laughing and having fun, because that's what this is designed for. We have pretty serious racing like at Electric Dreams. Our F1 class, our Group C class are fairly serious. And so this is an attempt to be, oh, look at that car roll over. Look at that guy. Oh, he took him out. Yeah, get him again. That kind of thing. So that's why it's a 3-lap crash and burn, winner moves on, drag race style elimination on the 2 center lanes. So
they look like motorized muffins.
Kind of, yeah, but they don't taste very good.
Yeah. I mean, of course, I have one, and they're super fun. But
they are super fun.
You pretty much just have to have a single car class with those.
If we do it as an actual class, this is just going to be a fun race.
Yeah, yeah.
If we do it as an actual class, it will be a spec class, these only.
Yeah.
And because they come in one configuration, some of the older ones have just a slightly milder motor, but it's close enough, it won't make any difference. And there's the new 3 Martinis are out now.
Yep.
And the Castrol ones are available. There's a few others available and so on. So hopefully it's going to be a fun class to go along with some of the more serious classes.
Awesome. Good stuff, Jim. And next up is Mr. Mike. Go ahead. Oh, you're still muted, buddy.
Okay, thanks. I wanted to talk a little bit about Garth's 3D printed wheels. These are five spoke that he got for me. And they're very light. I tested them for 225 lap races with myself with this car, the sideways McLaren 720S, which is a great car, by the way. Same tires, just swapped the tires over to the wheels. Difference in lap time was about half a hundredths, so not a lot. They are lighter. The original wheels on those are 1.34 grams. The 3D printed one with the insert is 1.07 grams. And the CBD design wheels that I tested on the car were 2.39 grams. There's a little bit of difference in the outside and inside diameter of the printed ones. Inner was 14.94, the outer was 15.02. Not a lot of difference, but it's there. So those of us who are really fussy may want to do a little truing on the wheels themselves, which would be fairly easy. Overall, you couldn't tell the difference. Although when I initially mounted them, and my methodology here was to do 125 laps on my road course and then swap only the wheels, same tires, and then run 125 laps again. When I changed to Garth's wheels, I immediately had four offs and four laps because the acceleration difference was so severe that I was punching it way too early. I had to be much more careful and turn the sensitivity down a little bit because even that small reduction in weight seemed to make a huge difference in the way the car handled. So not really a negative factor in that regard, just something that you can tune out. If you're using those, you can do that as a matter of tuning with weight or whatever to get the car to handle the way you want it. But all in all, I'm really satisfied with them. It's like, what's not to like? They're cheap, with about $3 per wheel. So, you know, it's a lot better than the $12 to $20 that other wheels get. And the sideways wheels, I think, are about $15 or $16 a pair, if I remember correctly. I didn't look it up, so don't quote me on that one. Yeah, they're really satisfactory. And not only that, these are the iterations that are not the lightest version that we've been talking about. The original wheels that were on the 720S are three spoke with a slot out of the center, and they're air wheels. So, you know, even with a solid center, they're still lighter than the air wheels. Regardless, they're just as true. And we're working on a version to be a 3D printed air wheel with three spokes on it. So we're going to see how that works and how well it holds up. I didn't have any problems. Of course, I didn't crash a lot, but you know, I don't know how they hold up overall in the long run. But regardless, you can do two or three of them for the cost of a set of aluminum ones. So it's the interesting thing that I noted when I first tested them out is that originally the wheels felt better. They felt more solid, the aluminum ones, than the 3D printed ones because of the lightness, I think. And so I had to readjust and figure out what was going on with those. But yeah, I think it's a great thing to do. And I hope Branch Design will be able to handle all the upkeep and manufacturing for those inserts, because man, they're great.
So what was the plastic that you had? Was it ABS or PETG or?
was ABS.
Okay. So weight wise, it should pretty much be the same regardless of the material. I mean, you know, maybe down to, you know, tenths of a gram difference, but otherwise, they'll all weigh about the same. And to me, the main advantage of the whole milled aluminum hub with 3D printed wheel system is the enjoyment of designing and printing your own wheels. It's remarkably easy. As I believe I've said before, you know, I could design a wheel in 5 minutes just off the cuff right now if you wanted me to.
Yeah.
but printing the wheel in whatever color you want the wheel to end up being, and having whatever spoke design you want the wheel to end up having, you don't have to do a plain, you know, air wheel and then find inserts that, you know, suit the car or float your boat or whatever the case may be. And then ideally in the long run, there will be, not only people offering, you know, printed wheels for you to go and, you know, install hubs into, but also just go download the files, right? Wheels are so easy to design, relatively easy to design as far as CAD is concerned. They're not easy to manufacture on a mill. You know, go talk to Steve at Ranch Designs. He'll tell you how hard it is to actually mill a wheel. But 3D printing a wheel is pretty easy, and designing it in CAD is not too hard. So hopefully down the road, we'll have a plethora, I love using big words, of wheels for free download that anybody with a half decent 3D printer can crank out on their printer. And then all Steve's got to do is crank out a bunch of hubs, and people can just go to town on custom wheels that they don't have to paint or put inserts in, that are light enough and strong enough and round enough and hold onto your axle hard enough to have fun with. I mean, it might not be winning a 24-hour endurance race, but maybe it will. Maybe Wayne will let us know later.
The advantage that I see is, especially when you have odd cars, like, for instance, this Pantera, the Carrera Pantera. They don't have any wheels on it now, but the wheels are just outrageous. I mean, you look at the, I don't know, it's hard to tell the size, but they're just really outrageous in size, and yet it doesn't, and nothing else looks decent in the body itself. So, you know, you have the ability to do that. This is a 19.8 wheel.
That Carrera one?
Outside diameter. And so in order to get something, you can adapt the wheel size to the car, and you can make it more scale or less scale, whatever you want, really relatively easily. And if you do destroy a wheel, you can still save the hub.
Yeah, you know, tear the wheel off and stick the hub into another print.
Yeah, cost you a buck to make another wheel.
Yeah. Well, if you've got your own printer, a couple of cents worth of material. Yeah,
right.
Well, plus there's the potential to replace stock wheels for even, you know, older Skeletrix cars or something along that line as well.
Oh, yeah, it would make it worth it in that regard. And I think that's probably a good idea. You know, for someone, when you get a wheel that keeps falling off on a Skeletrix car, for instance, you have to glue it on, and a lot of times it'll come off in the race. Well, you can true the Skeletrix axles well enough, significantly, by taking the knurling off, that you can put a regular wheel on it. And so this would be a replacement wheel, and you can make it, you know, you can make it an insert wheel if you want and use the old one for the insert, or you can make them however you want with whatever design you want, and forego the insert even. I mean, forego the cosmetic insert on the outside. So yeah, I mean, it's like a win-win for everybody.
Good stuff. I love hearing your experimenting and the reports of your findings. And I'm sure we'll hear more about that whole concept in the future. Did anybody else have any questions or comments for Mike?
I just want to say, well done, Garth. Way to go.
That's a great concept.
Is there a link where those are available? Or can you put the link in the chat?
Hopefully Garth can throw the link in the chat for us. I believe Steve of Ranch Design has a post or a thread or maybe even a sub forum on Home Racing World's forums, and links to his order sheet, and the hubs are now on that order sheet. So if you wanted to experiment with the concept, just send Steve an email. If you don't have a printer, I'll be happy to print wheels for cheap for people. Hopefully down the road, we'll have links to other people in other countries who voluntarily offer their services to print wheels for people in other countries, UK, Europe, Australia, at least would be nice. But yeah, I mean, ideally, I mean, because we understand that 3D printing will become fairly ubiquitous in the not too distant future, the idea is that it will be much more accessible, democratically accessible, or whatever they like to say, democratizing the technology. But yeah, so yeah, contact Steve for the hubs, contact me for prints, or anybody else for prints. If you got a printer or a friend with a printer, go to town. Big Dan, I feel like you have a question or comment on this.
Well, just for Jim, I think I'd noted the Ranch Design email address when Garth was on a couple of weeks ago, and it's the one I've got is ranchdesign@heartofiowa.net. Would no dots in between Heart of Iowa.
Is that Branch Design or Ranch Design?
Ranch Design, Jim.
Ranch Design, okay.
Like ranch dressing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not hard to find. If you just do a Google for Ranch Design wheels or something like that, you're sure to find that thread. But yeah, good stuff. Thanks, Mike. And next up is Mr. Den. Go ahead, Big Den.
Oh, g'day, fellas. Just a word for John Kitt before we start. I was actually a little bit surprised that you thought the Queen might have been into slot cars. I thought everyone knew she collects corgis.
But
That's awesome. Awesome.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to try a share screen, but I'm going to use a different graphics program because for some reason Windows wouldn't open these files I've got. So I'll just. Okay, is that looking? You've got that one?
Here it comes.
Yep. Okay, these are a couple of things I got on eBay recently. They're Lindbergh SnapFit kits.
1/32nd.
Sorry, say again.
What scale?
Here we go. 1/32nd. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, 1/32nd. Yeah, so that's the box art from on the back. There's a picture of the two bodies, and this is where show and tell turns into show and yell. Can you tell me that the car in front is 32nd scale?
Lindbergh has a history of making sort of 32nd scale-ish cars.
Yeah, so it seems as what I've done is inadvertently joined the 1/43rd scale slot racing phenomenon, you know. So yeah, so if Alan or any of the guys in Leo are in 140, they know of anyone in Australia who might like a couple of smaller scale cars, I'm quite happy. But the other possibility is we've had a bit of rain around here, and if eBay didn't pack, the people didn't pack the property, they could have shrunk, you know, on their way between the seller and the purchaser. Yeah. So
that's not even one. That's 1/43rd ish. That's 1/32nd ish, 1/40th ish, 1/43rd ish.
Yeah, yeah. There's a lot of ish in there. Yeah. So you know, foiled again. So.
That's too bad.
Yeah. Okay, so that's all in the sharing there.
All right. Thanks, Big Ben. And I got a quick little show and tell. Since Russ is not on, I'm going to show and tell on his behalf. And my screen is deciding to share other things. Come on. There we go. Okay. So I decided to spend a few minutes taking pictures of the various accoutrement around Russ's fantastic racing room. And when you walk in the door, the first thing you see is the slot car commandments. I'm sure most of you have seen this, of course. I'm racing to have fun. A mad driver is a bad driver. The turn marshal didn't wreck. I did. The more I relax, the better I drive. That should be number one. Sometimes I need to slow down to go faster, or maybe that should be number one. It's not like I never nerfed anyone. Don't be so serious. After all, we're racing toy cars. Be a good loser, and more importantly, a good winner. Watch your mouth. If I can't follow the rules, shouldn't be racing. This should be up in every racing room. And so we're going to take a cruise around his interesting things. And I was hoping he'd be able to be on to kind of tell us why he's displaying these particular items. But like I said before, it's just a fun range, a walk through history. I don't know if these things were things that he had as a child or desperately wanted as a child, or he just thinks that they're cool and interesting bits of slot car history. So basically a variety of shelves with this variety of slot car stuff. It does seem that a lot of them are HO. For whatever reason, we have a set of the Skelextric carts that came in the racing set, but we've got some 143rd and some Skelextric Micro and some HO cars and some things like that, and a Daytona Lighted Racing and some slot car mechanic books. What years did these come out? That looks like a 60s, 70s kind of thing. I don't know. If anybody recognizes any of the things on any of these photos, by all means, chime in and give us some interesting tidbits about it.
Well, that VW van looks like it's a home built, because I that kind of looks like the Tom Daniel monogram model that's been put on a chassis.
Mm-hmm. Certainly could be. I didn't dare to take things off the shelves and explore them with too much depth. I just took pictures. And there's the tin plates that Dennis worked on. We've got a Skelextric Pacer car. This was a gift to me from a person in the community. I had done my job with it, and I gifted it to Russ because he wanted to play around with it. Highway Pioneer model kit of some sort. Race and Road Speedway by Marks. I mean, that looks almost too small to be a complete HO scale racing set.
Still, that box art is so cool.
Right? Mm-hmm. A lot of these are basically just about the cool boxes. And then, of course, he's got a range of tin plate cars and other cars here.
Now, is all this around the edge of his track?
These are basically around the walls of his three-car garage, which is where his track is. So pretty much every wall has some kind of display of slot car something.
And that's so just clean. I'm sorry, that's just way too organized.
And not a speck of dust anywhere.
And after I started putting these in this album to share, I realized that there were more pictures I should have taken. Like he has these like tool benches that are these real nice wood tool benches with all kinds of wonderful drawers and things, and a whole just power strip. The whole wall is just one long power strip. So you can put your slot car boxes, and everybody's got somewhere to plug a thing into if they feel the need. It's like it could be an establishment, like a commercial establishment. But yeah, it's fantastic. And of course, the best is yet to come. We've got some books on display and some other cars and things. This, I'm sure some of you recognize this. You know, I have no idea what this is long before I was even born, but you know, it's like it just came off the shelf from back in time.
Wow. It's also, look at that. It's also CSA approved. Wow.
Yep. Got to be safe. Which lane chicane? You know, okay. I assume this is based on some kind of AC2 car where the cars could end up in either lane when they go through the crossing. Yeah. That looks like all kinds of fun. I'm sure John knows all about that controller. But, you know, American Flyer stock car racing, you know, just model kits. And he's got a straight up jukebox, like legit. I even donated some of my old 45s so that they could add some classic 80s into their jukebox.
Wow, that looks like a Seaburg. Is it a Seaburg?
I don't know anything about the jukebox itself other than it works. He tends to use Alexa for his music, but, you know, the jukebox still works. And then, of course, you know, he's pretty much all of his cars he keeps in the box so he can display them. But he also has a nice case that he puts cars in boxes and cars outside of boxes in. Convenient place to store controllers for the people who are there and don't want to, you know, shouldn't have the controller around their neck, as we often do, because when you're marshalling, controllers dangling onto the track are hazards. So put your controller here and more cars on the shelf. And I believe the next photo is...
Oh, wait, hold on. I love that sign.
Oh, yeah.
That is cool.
Yeah. He's got some other signs, tin signs of various kinds around. I believe the next photo is the spread that his wife puts out. And yeah, I really need to remember not to have dinner before I come to race at Russ's.
Full
charcuterie. And parfait. Strawberry shortcake parfait.
Did you see those were meat flowers?
Yeah, meat flowers, cheese, crackers. He's even got over here, we got caprese.
Is on that a stick. All free?
It's all free. You know, he doesn't charge a dime. We can just come there and then, you know.
It's a good meeting to go to then.
Yes, absolutely.
Tony, it's worth the airfare.
There you go. I try not to miss any races at Russ's. His is one of the, he's not the furthest track for me to drive to, but it's one of the furthest tracks.
Where is it?
It's in Graham, Washington. I'm in Auburn. Because rush hour is going from my location to his location in the evening, takes me an hour to do that drive, which is normally about a 40-minute drive. So not that much longer, but I'm either taking the back roads or I'm stuck in traffic the whole way. So it's not an enjoyable drive to get there. But it's worth it.
In California would say only an hour.
Yeah. And in the
Dennis,
UK,
that's
it's
exactly
like,
what I was going to say. Exactly. An hour?
And the guys in the UK are going like, what are you guys, nuts? An hour? That's ridiculous. Anyways, you know, Russ's track, you guys have seen the track multiple times. It's a fantastic wooden track with that huge, long, banked turn, first turn and everything. Everything else in the room, just as great as the track.
Talk about time and driving to go 5 miles. It takes maybe a couple of hours.
Yeah, but you guys got better mass transit than we do over here. Yeah, you got the underground and all kinds of buses and things.
Yeah. That's in the center, not out in the sticks. There's no underground line. There's overline.
That's fair. I don't live there, so I can't talk.
The underground's supposed to come this way, but it got stopped.
Yeah, and they're building light rail over here. They're trying, but it never can keep up with the population growth. So,
British Rail have been saying for the last 60, 70 years, we're getting there, and they still ain't got there.
It'll never get there. Anyway, that's the end of show and tell. Does anybody else have anything they want to show or tell? Feel free to wave your actual hand.
I'm waving my hand.
Okay, Chris, go ahead.
Okay, what do I want to show you guys? A new motor manufacturer that will be out very, very shortly. Dennis will know where this came from. You see that? Am I up?
Yeah, yep, it's up.
Okay, this is a Czechoslovakian company that anybody who has raced commercial slot cars will know of. The company is called Kohoza. It's run by a guy named Radim Hayek out of the Czech Republic. And he has recently launched a range of, this is obviously an S-Can or an FC-130 motor. And he's also launched some FK-180s. Like the rest of his stuff, it is really well made, really meticulously made. The interest for these motors, both the FC-130s and FK-180s, will be predominantly amongst the guys who run on plastic tracks. These all have polyneo magnets in them, so they will offer some pretty significant downforce on a plastic track rail. They're made in, this one obviously is a 30K S-CAN motor. They make them in a range from 21.5 up to 48K. The nice thing for the guys who run FK180 motors, much more on plastic tracks in England and Europe, all his FK180 motors have an upgraded brush system and an upgraded comm. So they'll be very, very nice motors for you guys as well. They look gorgeous. These are pretty crummy pictures. Like all of his stuff, they look tremendous. He spent a little more money on the assembly. A lot of times when you'll get a motor, the stack is not centered in the magnetic field. And if you pick up the motor and sort of, you know, touch either end of the motor shaft, you'll come find it. It doesn't actually move either way. It's sort of butted up against one or the other of the bushings. They've taken a little more time. They use a spring setup. This is like a U-shaped clip here to hold the magnets in. They spent a little more time in aligning the magnets in the armature, so the armature runs in the center of the magnetic field. Probably the biggest difference is the longevity of that. It'll be a little more efficient, and you probably won't wear out bushings if you have a motor without the armature sort of skewed one way or the other. So they're about a buck more expensive than most of the popular motors out there. I have tested a few of them already. I've tested the 21.5Ks on a wood track. At this point in time, if you've got a 21.5K Perenner or a 20,000K NSR, there's really no need to switch from a pure performance perspective. I suspect these may last a little bit longer, but if you're running on a plastic track and your rules allow you to play no magnet racing, you get a hell of a lot of downforce off of these motors. And one other thing, if I may, anybody questions? Go ahead.
Where are they going to be available?
That's what I was just going to say.
The 21.5s and the 25s are already available from Electric Dreams.
Yeah.
Okay.
Does Electric Dreams have any of the FK180s yet, Dennis?
No, just the short cans.
Okay.
And just right. Those two RPMs.
Yeah.
Chris?
Yeah.
As far as a spec motor goes, do you think because of the quality, these would be closer in consistency from motor to motor if somebody wanted to run a classic spec motor?
The biggest benefit that I can see of these motors so far is the fact that they have a little more care and precision in how they're put together, centering the arm in the magnetic fields, blah, blah, blah. The ones I've tested so far seem to be very consistent. Now, I haven't tested 1,000. I've tested 6 or 7, but they seem much more consistent than anything else. So I think, yes, one of the benefits for them will be a really good spec or handout motor. Anything else?
Oh, yeah, Chris, what? How did you test the motors? Sorry if you don't mind me asking.
You put them in a slot car, you put them on a track and drive them around.
Oh, okay, so you didn't like put it on a bench, you actually put it in a car, which is cool.
That's the only way to test a slot car motor.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, free running RPMs is not indicative of...
No, it doesn't tell you basically much of anything.
So what are the magnets in them, Chris?
Sorry, John?
What are the magnets? Are they Neomax?
Yeah, well, they're all poly-neos.
Yeah. The trouble is, in the UK, you won't be able to use them.
Okay, well, that's, you know, as I said in my thing, you have to go rules being rules.
You might be able to get away on obviously, one of the wood tracks.
Sorry?
You might be able to use them on some of the wood tracks.
Well, you should be able to use them on any wood track unless you've got MagnaBlade or something like that on the track.
Won't allow them because of the, basically, as you said, it's a magnet car.
Yeah, I mean, the other nice thing for a wood track is the polyneos are a tad lighter than ceramics and stuff like that, so it frees up a little bit of weight so you can position it better around the perimeter of the chassis. Mm-hmm. And then one more thing, seeing the Eldon cars I have recently finished a Strombecker Lotus 19.
Oh, wow.
Took, I don't know if any of you ever seen the Strombecker Lotus 19s. They're hideous, bloody looking things, but no one else really makes one. So I decided to reshape the sills and do a whole bunch of stuff. So this, I went to the 1961 Players 200 at Mosport. My dad was a scrutineer back at the time for a lot of the track. So this was the car entered by Akira Koss for Moss in the 61 Players 200. There are no paint chips. I went to an automotive paint supply guy, and they were tremendous to sell me a $20 can of paint. They mixed up all kinds of stuff to try and get it close. But and being a car from that era, that's not the greatest shot, but another shot of that. So the color to my eye looks a lot like the color I remember from the day. It looks about 1,000 times better than the Strombecker ever did. And being a car from the early 60s, I really tried to get an old world chassis built for this thing. And in terms of simple chassis that Dennis and everybody was talking about before, this is basically a brass plate cutout. I have a Strombecker Skuttler motor. There are two balsa wood blocks running down the side on the inside of the sills, and they are screwed on there. So that was, if you were club racing in the, you know, mid early 60s, that's very much like what you'd be running around.
You just need to find you a proper Cox gear for that.
I do have a Cox gear in there now. I've also dyed all my old Parma PSE gears black, so they look better as well.
Pink is faster, though.
Sorry?
Pink is faster than black.
Absolutely. And yeah. One from the top. This is very much period correct.
I love it.
Just a Strombecker Skuttler motor. Actually, underneath the bulkheads here, I drilled a couple of holes, and then I used some machine screws up through the bottom of the pan to basically bolt the back of the motor and the bracket in there. One of
Penrose's brackets?
Yeah, it's a BWA bracket soldered onto the piece here. So this whole thing is sort of loosely mounted with a couple of small silicone washers under to give a bit of flex. Goes around, I mean, it's a Skuttler motor. I don't know if that means much to a lot of you guys, but it's far from the quickest motor by far.
Weren't they originally used for like model trains?
Well, pretty much all of the open frame motors that you see, like the Pitmans and everything, yes, they were originally found in electric trains. They did sort of modify them a little bit. The Pitmans came with motor brackets or axle brackets back here and some stuff like that, but it was just sort of a flashback to the old days. And when I saw the Eldons come up, I just thought I'd pop this up for you too.
Very cool.
But it's still Strombecker, I mean, you did a lot of work on that body, but they still look better than the Eldons.
Oh, I've got, I mean, the Lotus 19 was the worst Strombecker body ever known to man, or the Lotus 19. Some of them are absolutely stunning looking. And then in terms of a simple chassis, Dennis was talking about, this is a variation on what Dennis is doing. This one goes under a Lotus 16 Scale Electric. That's not just
quite what I would call simple. Hmm? That's not quite simple because they've got all that flex in them, all that twist in the middle. But yeah, that's not. I like it. I've seen that one before.
A variation of, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Anyway.
Again, simple to you, Chris, but to the rest of us.
Well, it's interesting, and you know, Dennis will attest to this. The design, ultimately the design of the chassis makes a difference. However, I've seen tons of high-tech design chassis that were executed poorly that wouldn't go around the track.
Yep.
And I've seen tons of real simple chassis that are nice and square and nice and straight and nice and true, and they just bomb around the track.
Yep.
Exactly.
I would agree with all of that.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now at the high end, you know, when you're trying to get the last couple of tenths or whatever you're trying to get, chassis design certainly goes a long way. But without execution, it's a complete waste of time.
And without a driver that can get
Well, that's that.
Hey, Greg, quit talking about me like that.
Yeah, like that Ten Commandments said, you know, get it.
Go slow. Well, you know, driver quality is, you know, I went to a fairly big U.S. university on a golf scholarship, and I had access to the best equipment, the best training, the best everything, and here I am talking to you guys about playing with toy cars. So something happened along the way, and I'm still blaming it on the equipment.
Yep. Must have been those dang clubs. Well, as always, a very educational show and tell from Mr. Walker. And I remembered something else that I wanted to share. I shared this with my club already because I'm trying to get them at a point where we can run another Ninco Classic series, which is hard to do when you've got a bunch of new members who don't already have Ninco Classic cars because they are hard to find and or very expensive. So Hobby Classic is a shop over in Europe. I don't know exactly where they are, but they advertised on Facebook that they had just gotten in a bunch of Ninco Classic cars. So I buzzed my butt over there, and the prices are very, very reasonable for these very rare and hard to find cars. I grabbed the two blue and yellow cars that they had on offering, and shipping from wherever the heck they are to here was only $20 on top of the very reasonable. A euro is pretty darn close to a dollar, a few cents more than a dollar, but close enough that when you look at that price, that's more or less what you're going to pay in US dollars. So, you know, if you don't have an Inco Classic, particularly with the NC1 motor, because they're low RPM, low power motors, these cars have narrow wheels and tires. They're just a blast to drive, but in an entirely different way than a lot of cars that most people have and gravitate towards. But yeah, if you don't have an Inco Classic.
The Ninco rubber that they use has always been very good, actually.
Very good rubber.
20x7s that are on those cars work really well.
Yeah, and it seems to last a good long time, too. That,
mm-hmm.
Like the car that I have, I think I have, I've got this, where did it go? It's under my people thing here. I got the Barchetta. There we go. There it is down there. I got that car and the white Testarossa as well. I have not yet received my new blue and yellow cars. I'll show and tell those when I actually get them, of course. But, you know, I gave them the opportunity to hit up this site and snag them some Ninco Classics for a good deal. But now it's up to you guys. If you don't have Ninco Classic in your collection, by all means,
grab them.
Get at least one because they're.
Hey, Greg.
Yes, sir.
Mentioning the NC1 motors that are in those, Far Out Rules limited it to NC1 and NC8 motors until this year. And Stephen is allowing us to use the Predator 12.5
okay.
motors. And they're maybe a little stronger than the NC1 and NC8 in some cases, but not in all. And the Predator motors at $8, you can't beat that, but they're equivalent. So if other people have the Nincos and they're out of the NC1, NC8 motors, I mean, there's a few of those out there, but guys are wanting $25 and $30 for them. Forget it.
Yeah. And one of the reasons that I'm kind of pushing it is with these blue and yellow cars coming into my collection, I can happily let go of my non-blue and yellow Ninco classic cars to guys in the club who don't have one.
There you go.
But I also have some other Ninco cars that were, you know, from whatever point in time that they put NC1s into a variety of cars. So I've got some cars that have NC1s that doesn't really matter that they have NC1s.
Right.
And I've got a spare NC1. So basically, you know, with the variety of cars on that site, a lot of them have NC1s. And if you end up buying an Ninco Classic that doesn't have an NC1, at least for my guys here in my club, I'm pretty sure I can dig up an NC1. You can give me whatever motor that car comes with, and I'll stick it in whatever car I pull the NC1 out of. And hopefully we'll have another Ninco Classic series coming up shortly.
When you guys run Ninco NC1s, do you turn the voltage up?
No, we usually leave it around 12 volts. We like, and because we run them no mag, so even on plastic track, we take out those brown, practically useless magnets that some of them come with. And they're just a hoot. You know, you can still overdrive them.
Oh, yeah.
They still crash at 12 volts, but yeah, you know, we don't feel the need to turn them up. The Ninco carts, those we crank up the voltage for.
Oh, but yeah, but that's the one of the most anemic motors ever put exactly. in a 130 seconds go car.
Yeah, even at 15 volts, those things barely.
Yeah.
But yeah, so get yourself an Ninco Classic and have some fun with a car that you might not normally have added to your collection. I always encourage people to, you know, if you have the budget, explore all the brands. You know, get at least one car from pretty much every brand. You know, get more from the brands you like, but you know, you should have at least one Fly. You should have at least one Ninco. You should have at least one SCX and one Skelectric and one Carrera. Yep. So you can say, you know, yeah, I hate that car, but you can't. But you can't really just take everyone's word for it, because some people like stuff that you don't like, and vice versa, right?
If you're gonna run Ninco, run an inline.
Yeah, like the classics are inlines. Yep. But yeah, Ninco, you know,
their Ninco Classics are probably one of our favorite local club classes.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest with you, we allow a few mods, like you can put bushings in and change the wheels and tires and do a few things on them. On most home club tracks, even with the motors that we run, which are 15,000 RPM motors, they are not appreciably slower than a well-turned, like they go around just great.
Yeah, I mean, the NC1's 14K at 12 volts, right? Or somewhere around?
Yes, we're 14. Using, because they're like hen's teeth right now, the original NC1s.
Yeah.
The motor that Al Penrose came out, which sort of an NC1 clone, it was a little bit quicker. Maybe about 15.5, somewhere around there. But a great class. And if you like to tinker, you can make them run just like the Fly cars. You can make them run great.
Yeah.
And you know, every slot car in your box does not have to be the world's fastest slot car.
Exactly. And I think the Ninco Classics are a great exemplary example of that. Yeah. All right, so we're at the tail end of show and tell. Does anybody else have anything they want to show and or tell? I think we wrung that dry. And I'm going to put you on the spot, Mr. McPhee. Have you been on our chat before? I don't recognize your name or face, but I'm terrible with names and faces.
I've been on a few times.
You're hiding in the back. Did you give us an introduction before?
So. What's that?
Okay. See, it's the glasses. I'll take that as my excuse. Okay, so we're ready to move on to Club Corner. If you have a Club Corner you want to share, as always, this is anytime you race with more than yourself. whether it's in a club or at home with your kids, this is now the time to share your happy racing memories or future memories. If you have something that you want to promote as a future club activity, put your virtual hand up and we'll make sure we get to you. And Mr. Maurer is ready to go. Tell us what happened, Mike. You're already unmuted.
Oh, I am. Yeah, I see that. Well, we tried something different. Just one of the guys showed up yesterday. We bailed on Monday because he had other things to do. But we did a 125 lap scale auto Formula Ones with everything but weather on. And I will tell you that the influence that that has on tire wear is significant. After wearing down my soft tires and having four offs and four corners, I decided it was probably a good idea to change tires. So it was an interesting experiment. I'm not fully done with that yet, but and those cars, by the way, are wonderful to race on my track. They're really, really fun. Mm-hmm. You have to turn them all the way down to Pro Maglis 25 in order to get the voltage down enough to make them manageable, but they're great cars. They really are fun. I enjoy them a lot. And this was an added challenge. So I don't know how much we'll incorporate it. Both of us were laughing our heads off. It's like, oh, this is crazy. And you couldn't compensate for it. I think probably if you had a SCP3 or something like that, we could have compensated, but I don't run those with the 7042 power base. So it was good fun. I enjoyed it. And I also raced mag cars with my buddy up in Chelan. And so I had a full docket this week, and it was really nice. It was good to do that. I still haven't been able to convert the buddy up in Chelan to Maglis, but we'll see. He's got a series of equal radius two S's that are just impossible with a Maglis car. They're just really, really difficult to get around. And he's so ensconced in the magnets, although he has turned a voltage down to Pro Maglis 50 on the Garcia 64 to make it a little bit more even. But still great fun. Like to have more people, because I'd like to get in the digital and have at least four or five guys to make it more mayhem and make it interesting, but we'll do what we can.
Did you run the stock tires on the scale autos, Mike?
Yes, I did. And they worked really, really well on the Scalextric track.
Okay. But you said they went off quickly or wore down quickly?
Oh, no, that was due to the influence of the RCS 64, management.
Yeah, the virtual tire.
So we were running both fuel simulation and tire wear. Okay. So when you wear your tires down, it gives more power to the controller right away. And it's like you touch it and you're off. So you have to really, really learn to drive it well.
And it messes
regardless with of your setup of the car.
So you can't go, it messes with your brakes too. So you can't go as deep in the corner.
Oh, when
your tires are worn down. That's what guys usually notice is it just went off full speed. No, it just didn't hit the brakes like you thought it would. Because you don't have any traction left.
Yeah, well, like I said, four offs and four corners, and it was time to change my tires, not pronto.
But you were, since you weren't doing
the one thing I noticed with.
Go ahead.
The one thing I noticed with those is that it's pretty vague on which tires are which in the menu. So that's going to take a little bit more looking at, especially for my old eyes.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, because it's got an H for hard or an S for soft.
Well, the only thing I saw, it said three sets or two sets, and when you toggle between.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry about the set numbers. So, there's a bug with the program right now that the set numbers don't actually come into play. The number of sets that you set,
Okay.
So basically, you're just, without weather, you're toggling either between hards or softs, or you're using, you're replacing whatever you were running with. A hard tire will last longer, but have a little bit less responsive brakes and acceleration. A soft tire has better response to brake and acceleration, but wears down faster. So
Well, it was interesting because we had sometimes a 4 or 5 lap deficit, and between damage and tire wear and all that stuff, it was real easy to make up 5 laps.
Oh yeah, especially with damage. Yeah, if you're doing damage,
pretty much interesting.
And does the computer affect your tire wear based on just pure lap times?
For the Skelectric Digital with the program that we're talking about, which is RCS 64, fuel is burned based on throttle usage. So the more high throttle you use, the more fuel is burned.
Yeah.
So not so much lap time, but throttle usage. And the tires are worn by laps, but as well as your braking. So if you tell the software that your track has, let's say, 9 braking points, but you brake an additional amount or you don't fully brake for some of them, then you'll either wear the tires a little bit faster or a little bit slower, depending on how close you are to the set number of brake points for your track.
Okay, good. See, none of that crap should be allowed in slot race.
Oh, you and Garth and I had a big discussion about those damn controllers, computers controlling the slot cars.
When the rain hits the track, you lose your acceleration and braking. You gotta go put on wet tires to get it back. Yeah.
If the sound of this appeals to anybody
out there, then digital is what you want. If the sound of this just gives you the willies, then you do not want to bother with digital. We love our simulations. Well, some of us, not everybody.
We beg to differ on that, Greg, because digital doesn't have to involve weather or tire wear.
You're right.
We do a lot of digital racing without even fuel.
That's true. But you're also doing actual 24-hour racings where actual tire wear comes into effect.
That's true, yes.
Yeah, I mean, so some of us like our simulation.
You can tailor it.
But you can still, exactly. You can do a digital race that's literally not in any way different than analog. You can even do round robin rotation with digital if you really want to. And the only difference is now you're sharing lanes and have lane changers. And that's enough for some people to not want digital. But I'm like, yeah, well, Mike, I love me some simulation. Like, exactly.
Yeah. The challenge of doing it was interesting. And even the one other guy that I raced with was the one who's a little bit more conservative and throws his hands up about that stuff. He thought, well, that was interesting to figure out. So, you know, slowly but surely I'm converting them to doing it. So it'll be fun. It was a fun exercise and I enjoyed it. We laughed a lot. And we also discovered that open wheel cars are really difficult to race side by side.
That is true no matter what kind of stock car racing it is.
Of torque.
Yeah, open wheelers are cars where the wheel, and that's I would imagine that one of the reasons that a lot of rule sets include your wheels and tires are not allowed to protrude from the body, you know, when looking down where whatever the rule is because it's pretty much any car where the wheels can rub is a whole different thing than cars where the wheels can't rub.
Yeah, because you touch and you're off.
Yep. All right, sounds like Mike had a lot of fun. Big Den, you want to talk about your fun?
Oh, Dad, there's no fun in this. This should be serious.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Mike laughing. Oh, that was outrageous.
Who does he think he is?
Yeah, I mean, all that digital stuff and tire wear, I'm with Chris on this. Yeah, keep it simple for us Tasmanians. So, although some people do have digital down here, so I just never met any. Greg, you were talking about a hobby classic. I think they're in Spain. You know, where you've got your Ninco cars. One of the interesting things that they've developed recently is a sort of a rejig of the old Scale Extric hill climb term. where you can turn your, you know, you've got a little teardrop at the end of the one end, yep. So you can actually make a single lane track. So if you've got limited space and things like that, so
or rally loops,
that's the sort of thing, yeah. And when it come to open wheelers, you know, I think it's great to see open wheel racing, F1s and with NSR and Scale Auto and those and the poly cars, because they became, mentioned on this many shows ago that open wheel sort of become a bit of a leper colony at some stage, and it's great to see them making a resurgence. And those of us who used to run the Scale ones back in the 90s, rebuilds of our old 60s cars and things, we used to have our saying, beware the open wheels. So it still applies. But now I'll get to a report, if I could, with the sharing the screen. And there we go. So we met again at Grumpy's Garage last Saturday. It was a little bit earlier than our other rotation so that we didn't conflict with another local club with our race dates. So 9 entries for racing, and we had 3 no-shows. One guy, as you can see there, he's still being knocked about a bit by the COVID. One visiting, and one of our chaps who lives quite a distance from the track, he sort of finds the travelling's a bit difficult for him now. So he was one of our top racers. Sad to see him not about. So started the day with our under 2-litre touring cars. Usual mix of brass cars and probably my Ninko plastic there, but most of the rest of them have some sort of brass influence in them. And another shot there as usual. And there's our results. So you can see that the brass cars are appreciably quicker. And I sort of drove the wheels off the Ninko car pretty much to get third, 6 laps behind. So on to race 2. And our V8 supercar class. And pleasingly for me, my rather ordinary driven to destruction set car in the front there was the quickest car on the day, although I must admit just by about 5 or 6 feet from Mark in second place. So it was pretty. So sometimes we don't race, the way the round robin rotation goes, we don't always race against one another, so it's not until the end of the series that you know where you are. But it was pretty close up the top there. The 3 of us were probably covered by less than a lap, so that's always good to see. And another pleasing aspect of the day is that some of the newer guys are upping their lap scores and becoming a lot more competitive. Kerry there in 5th place and very close for 5th place. He's a guy that's only been to about 3 or 4 of our meetings, so it's nice to see some of the new guys getting up against amongst the lap scores. So, and the last class for the day was our classic sports cars. Now, that again is me on the front spot there. I didn't race that. That is like Chris was saying earlier about simple chassis often working well. That is a fly chevron at the front, but I'd only ran that in the last of the 3 heats. So I started off with a Thunder Slot McLaren, then followed up with a slotted Ferrari similar to the one on the back row there, the number 2 car. But curiously, I got the same score, 93 laps, I got the same score in each of the 3 heats. So probably in the first couple of heats, I had more hits than the Beatles, and I didn't manage to score to the full potential of the cars. But again, the little fly car with some of these other smaller class cars it can be pretty competitive if you get a good run and you sort of drive it within what it is. So, and not a nice looking bunch of cars there, all up with a couple of Thunder Slots and some. Yep, 3 or 4 slotted there. And there's the gory story. Now, I haven't got any any lap by, you know, bracket by bracket or heat by heat breakdown of scores, because it's we seem to have this recurring problem late in the day when the natural light goes down, that the about the middle of the race the lap counting system starts to break up. So we had to pause the race, make a note of the scores, after about six of the nine heats, and note the scores down manually, and then adjust them at the end there again, I beat the same guy by about the same 5 or 6 feet. in my race there, and again, some of the newer guys getting up in decent scores there. Kerry, our new guy, and young Bill, he's only about 8 or 9, and he's starting to make his presence felt with some decent scores. So I haven't been to Hobart and for a month or so with the Australian GT series, but I thought I'd show you their pictures from down there. So this was their full field from race one, which was held a couple of weeks ago. Mainly NSRs, I think, but
there's some scale autos in there.
Yes, I think the Spike is a scale autos, I think, from memory. I had one of those and put it on eBay. I couldn't get it to work. So. And there's just the other end of the field. Some individual shots.
Yes, and,
I have one. Oh, sorry. Was that a bit quick? So there's Spiker. I don't know. They all look the same to me, some of these, except the Spikers. The Porsche doesn't, of course. And that was the podium from the first week with Dennis's friend Phil at the front, where he seems to be a lot of the time. So. And I'll stop the share because that's as much as I've got.
All right. Good stuff. Good racing. It's always good to see.
Good fun.
Dewan was here a second ago. Are you still there, Dewan?
Yes, I am.
Oh, okay, so you turned off your camera. That's cool.
I did? Oh, how did I do that? I didn't mean to do that. Sorry about that.
That's okay. No big deal. But you had something you wanted to ask for help on. Go ahead.
Okay. I was looking for some people in the Michigan area. There it goes. Oh, there we go. Yeah, I had a few questions, actually. But I was wondering if anybody in the Michigan area of Pittsburgh, and if so, I'd like to private message you guys, private message me if you could. I'm looking for a couple of favors on carrying out some tasks, but I had some questions regarding, especially you guys talking about the digital racing and things like that, and I know that the race management system that we have with the race coordinator has a lot of features in this analog that mimics some of the digital racing things, such as the fueling and the required pit stops and things of that nature. And one of the questions I had was in regards to the interchanging from digital to analog. I know several people have the systems that allow you to have either directly switch it from analog to digital versus switching out to track to do that. But converting your cars over, you're committed to go one way or another when you get like a slotted car to go and make it either Skeletric Digital or Career Digital, etc. I guess my question is how challenging is that for people to have multiple sets of cars to do, and at least the one thing about career cars themselves is they do have the polarity switch to allow you to switch between the two different modes and use the same car for both sessions. But are there other cars that do that, or are you just kind of committing to one standard of analog versus digital when you cross the line and put in a chip in it?
So being a self-proclaimed expert in that kind of thing, I'll go ahead and answer that question.
Okay.
The too long didn't listen part is if you want good analog control, take out the chip. Don't have any chip of any kind in there. And if you want, you know, there are some digital chips that allow some kind of analog control, but none of them are optimum analog control. The Carrera digital chip has a built-in analog functionality. As you mentioned, the polarity switch allows you to, you know, use it in whatever polarity you want. The way that the chip actually switches to analog mode is when it's placed on an analog track with the correct polarity. That's what the chip is for. You pull the trigger three times, the chip gets three pulses of straight analog power with no digital signal, and it says, oh, I'm on an analog track, I'll be in analog mode now. The reason I don't suggest that one uses a Carrera digital car in analog mode is because you have no control over the braking strength. Even if you have a controller that has a brake adjustment knob, that car is always going to have 100% brakes. You simply can't change it. So if you want to be able to adjust the brakes for the best performance of that car, take the chip out. In the convenient part of Carrera's design is that the chips are connected to the braids and the motors and the lights and everything with little disconnectable plugs. So you could open the car up, unplug the lead to the chip connection and unplug the chip to the motor connection and then plug those straight together. So the chip is still technically in the car, but the car is no longer a digital car. The power is just going straight from the braids to the motor. And I believe that will actually end up being the correct polarity for analog. It's been a while since I've tested that.
Yes, that's correct. That's what I've done in this
one. Yeah, so that works. You know, if you've got a Carrera digital car, you want to race in analog mode, that would be my suggestion. Open it up, do the plugs. Skelectric digital chips also have an analog functionality. You don't need to do anything special other than stick it on an analog track. The downside to that chip is that it has no brakes. Yet. No brakes at all. It always will just coast and as far as it will coast with no brakes. So you can't make it have brakes if the chip is still in there. So for Skelectric cars, if it's a digital plug ready car with the hatch and everything, I would suggest taking the hatch out and putting in an analog blank door so that it's a pure analog car again. I don't believe any of the other digital systems have an analog mode functionality. Some of the systems allow you to race the digital car on an analog track, like Scorpius Wireless and Slotted Oxygen, because you're basically going to leave the chip in and you're going to race it as a digital car by bridging the power on your analog lane so that the lane gets full power just as if the car is on a digital track. It just doesn't have any lane changing. But you'd have to control it with its controller. An oxygen car will require the slotted SCP or Skelectric ARC controller. The Scorpius car will require the Scorpius wireless controller. So, you know, there are options, obviously. If you want a digital car that will work on as many tracks as possible, currently my opinion is that the best option is the slotted oxygen Type C chip, which you can install native Skelectric digital control firmware into, which means when you put it on the Skelectric digital track, you use the Skelectric digital controllers. It's a Skelectric digital car. You can also install Carrera native firmware. So same thing, put it on a Carrera digital track. It's a Carrera digital car. You don't use the SCP controller, you use the Carrera controller. Or obviously it's an oxygen chip. You put the oxygen firmware in there. Or if you want to run it on an analog track, then you bridge the wires, like I mentioned earlier, and run it on an analog track. Otherwise, you're going to want to bypass or remove the chip in order to swap the car between types of tracks. The track being able to run digital versus analog is a whole separate discussion. Did you want me to get into that as well?
I'll go without that.
Yeah, so like I said, the too long didn't listen is just go ahead and bypass or remove the chip. Hopefully it's easy. Depending on the chip, it might not be that easy. But if you know in advance, when you're installing a chip into a car, if you know in advance that you're going to want to run that car on an analog track without a bunch of hullabaloo, then install your own plugs so that you can unplug the chip and plug the plug the guide directly to the motor, so you don't have to sit there and move the chip to run it on an analog track.
Hey, wait, Dewan's there. I wanted to ask him, how you doing there, Dewan?
I'm coming along quite well. Thank you for asking.
He's well enough to join us after PT. He just had physical therapy, and he still came to the chat. So he must be doing good. So good for you.
That's good, Dewan. Glad to hear it. I did have a question. It came up twice in this last few days. Is there a chip out there for the Scalextrix F1s, which are a real small area, that will work on Carrera? I've been told no by more than one person, but yeah, is there one out there?
I would say if you're talking about the Scalextric F1 cars, Scalextric brand F1 cars, or NSR, right, Skill Auto should be good enough too, that already have a room for a chip, the Scalextric chip, you just want to put it on a Carrera Digital. Correct. And I would say yes, except you're not going to buy a Carrera Digital chip. You're going to buy a Carrera Digital compatible chip from a third-party manufacturer, such as Slot Technic is one of them, but I think there's another one that's smaller. I don't remember the name of it off the top of my head.
DDL.
Yeah, that's the one.
There are some out there.
C43 might fit too.
Yeah, the
okay.
Yep. There is one. If you want to go the smallest Carrera Digital compatible chip installation that I've seen so far is the FTL or whatever the one Don mentioned on slotforum.com. There is a Carrera Digital guy who just posted how he took one of those chips and he chopped off the connectors that are designed to have the lights plugged into them. Because if it's an F1 car, it doesn't have lights. It doesn't need lights. So you can chop off that whole connector bit, and the rest of the chip is still fully functional. You've got the wires for the guide to the motor and to the LED. It makes the final chip pretty darn small, and you can put it just about anywhere.
So, yeah, I'm selling a few of my Scalextrix F1s, and a guy sent me a question regarding that. I told him I didn't think so, but today I wanted to ask.
What you've always got to remember is that with Carrera Digital, the sensor is 12 millimeters to the left of the center of the car. So on a lot of those Formula Ones where they're so narrow up there, is all of that's going to stick outside the body, right? So you have aesthetics issue if you're somebody who likes the look of the car. Now all of a sudden you've got electronics sticking out from underneath, and you have possible damage issues because the chip is sticking out. Because most of the modern chips now, they don't have a fly lead with a separate LED on the end of them. The LED is on the board, right? And if it's a sports car, it's not a problem because getting 12 millimeters to the left of the center line of the car is no great issue. But you know, on a lot of Formula One cars, it is an issue. So you're going to have to chop away at the body and maybe at some of the barge board, or you know, if the car is one of those that has barge boards, and you know, if you're looking at a Lotus 33 or a 25 from Scalextric, it's going to be a whole bunch of stuff sticking out.
Yeah, that's one of the advantages of this. Let me highlight Don. I think he's showing off the chip here. Yeah, that's actually not even the small one that I was thinking of. There's another one that's even smaller than that. That's got a row of connectors on one end for lights. But to Dennis's point, you know, the nice thing about the chip that I'm thinking of, and maybe I'll go dig it up and we'll talk about it a little bit more later, but it is, everything is on fly leads, right? The only connectors there are, there's nothing on the board other than wires and connectors. So it already has the LED on fly leads. It already has, you know, leads for the motor and for the guide. So find a place in the car that the chip can be, wherever it can fit on the barge boards, like he was saying, and then find a place for the LED. And I think in the example that I'm thinking about, he basically hot glued it up, just tucked in behind the front struts so that it was, you know, being held in place, but otherwise.
Yeah, I've hot glued them onto the suspension parts at times as well.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can hide the chip way up underneath above the motor in that, you know, if it's one of those Formula Ones that has a it has a an airbox on top. You can hide it up there.
Yeah. So tell your potential buyer, yes, there are options. There are more options for those who are a little more adventurous in their chip installation, you know, duties. So yeah, Kelly had a great question that he posted in the chat to me, and I'm going to go ahead and post the question to everybody. What is a good, and I'll go ahead and add the word value, variable voltage power supply for your typical home track? Okay, he's not trying to power a club track, not trying to, you know, run crazy fast commercial wing cars and stuff like that. But what's a good value variable voltage power supply that he could use for analog racing or even to power, you know?
Pyramid PS26KX.
The pyramids, yeah, that's a good standby. That's what I've got running on my track.
And he's not reading that. He's doing that from memory, of course.
Yeah, I mean, when I first started, that was basically what everybody said was the Pyramid PS20, yeah, the 26KX or whatever it was.
What's the volt and amperage ratings on those?
That pyramid is 25 amps, so it's way more than you're ever going to need, and it runs from, I think, 6 to 15 volts.
Yeah. Which is pretty much 6 to 15 volts pretty much covers what most of us would need.
Yeah, unless you're trying to run Carrera
or
Carrera 124 scale cars, or unless you're trying to run HO scale, maybe.
Yeah.
I saw for the there's one at the Electric Dreams, the Professor Motor that has has a 20 volt and 12 amps. Mm-hmm. 10 amps. Okay, yeah, 10 amps.
10 amp is fine too.
There's lots of them out there, Dewan. I mean, one of the things you want to make sure that it's a regulated power supply.
Yes.
Amperage. Don't under amp yourself. If you have 5 to 10 for most home tracks, you're fine. But if it's 30 or 40, don't worry about that. The motors will only take what they want.
Uh-huh.
And always just leave the amp like right up to the right, like just dial it right up to the top and the motors will take what they want. But I mean, there's tons of supplies out there for, you know, $75-$100 that work fine.
What I usually recommend to people for when they're wanting a budget but capable is go to Amazon and type in 0 to 30 volt 10 amp power supply, and you'll just see just dozens and dozens of Chinesium power supplies that are basically, you know, you've got your digital readout and you've got your coarse and fine tuning knobs for voltage and amperage. Set your voltage to exactly whatever voltage you want. Like Chris said, just crank the amps all the way up. 10 should be plenty for pretty much anything that any of us are doing with, you know, 4 or less lanes or 6 or less digital cars. And they work just fine. I mean, they might not be like the best regulated power supplies on the market, but they do the job and they're a good value.
Right.
Has anyone ever been tempted to use a power supply manufactured for tattoo artists? When I was looking around on AliExpress for similar devices, I found twin output variable voltage power supplies with enough range and enough current to service two separate supplies to separate lanes on a two-lane track.
I've seen them suggested for single output to supply, you know, per lane. And you can usually pick those up for fairly cheap, and they have a good range of voltage and enough power for one car. I hadn't seen the two output one. How many amps did those say they had?
I think it was 2 times 10 amp. The other feature that was really, really easy to adapt to become a track call button was the fact that they are already wired and often supplied with a foot pedal. Not that you would use the foot pedal, but you would mount a switch to replicate the foot pedal. Yeah. And of course, they use them to vary the output, but you could just put a single pole, single throw type switch and just switch the track power on and off with the facility that's already manufactured in there, separate wire, separate plug-in device.
What were you going to say, Alan?
To consider having a look at.
Alan, you had some input?
Yeah, I've been using a power supply, I guess, for about the last 10 years now. I don't recall what the model number is, but the manufacturer is Mastech, M-A-S-T-E-C-H.
Yep.
And what I like about this unit, it actually has two separate channels. Each channel you can adjust 0 to 30 volts, 10 amps, or you can put jumpers in the back and the one channel becomes the master and you can go from 0 to 30 volts, 20 amps.
What's that unit going to run?
I paid less than $100 for it. Now that was a few years ago. So God only knows what it is today. But I'll have to look at the model number on it, but it became very versatile as far as my road course is concerned, but where I primarily use it is my two-lane drag strip. Yeah. I can really, you know, adjust each lane down to what needs to be. Say what?
Don't worry. It was somebody in Dewan's room. Okay. I already did it, Dewan. I got you. You're good. I mean, it sounds like a great power supply, but yeah, the question is what are they running these days? And are they even still available? Sounds like Chris is familiar with them. Do you know if they're still available?
I don't, but I've certainly heard of them and known a lot of guys that use them over the years. You know, there's Pyramid, Samlex makes unbelievable power supplies, but they're $700 a piece. So for $150, keep it simple and just make sure it's regulated and you're going to be fine. Yep. You know, generally the more bells and whistles, and if you can have this that adds to this and this will do this, there's just more little electric components to break down. I mean, all you're looking for is power.
Yeah, we love our Pyramid. It works really, really well.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you all think of the MFJ? I bought it a few years ago for 100. They're about 150 now, and it's a 30 amp up to 14 volts.
Well, nobody. How long have you had it?
I've had this one now 2 years.
No problems?
No problems whatsoever.
In which case, it's a great power supply.
Good point.
Yeah, I mean that's the one risk you're taking with the cheap Chinesium, you know, power supplies off of Amazon is, when will they die,
What about power tests? The better ones tend to have like a small internal fan, and a separate fuse that you can take out, which is also a bonus as well. That can save you some money over time.
Yeah, so good features to keep a lookout for when you're shopping is whether it has a user replaceable fuse and a fan to cool it. And the one that I got, I don't remember what brand it is or how much I paid for, but it was exactly the kind that I'm recommending. I got it for other purposes, but when it starts pulling the amps, I can hear the fan crank up inside the machine, and it's got a little fuse in the back that you can pull out and replace if necessary.
You know, like any of this stuff, if you plan to have it for 10 years, 5 years, 7 years, if you spend an extra $20 or $30 on it, for God's sake, it's money well spent.
Yeah, buy it once. And Dewan, I think you just asked about power taps.
Yeah, I was going to say, we know that there's a certain rule of thumb on adding power taps throughout the larger layouts and things like that.
My rule of thumb is as many as you're willing to put in.
Right.
There's no such thing as too many power taps.
Yeah.
I took Greg's advice on that. I put an 8 on my track, and I think I overdid it, but glad I did it.
Yep. You can't overdo it.
You can't overdo it.
How long is the track, Jeremy?
I think he's looking it up. You're still muted. You muted yourself, Jeremy.
I think it was like 57 feet is every all of it.
Yeah, my track's shorter than that, and I have 9 power taps, and every track is soldered to the next track within those 9 power taps.
Wow.
So it's basically solid wire. But for Jeremy's track, it might have been overkill right now, but as time goes by and more racing is done on that, you'll definitely be glad you put in that many power taps.
Yeah, the general rule of thumb in a lot of the European or the Italian plastic car tracks is they put a tap in every 10 sections, not feet. So if you've got a 6-inch section, it counts just as much as a 14-inch section. So every 10 sections, a power tap.
Because it's not about the length, it's about the loss of power through every
Number of connections.
Yeah.
And when you're doing it, you know, to solder or clip an extra couple of sets of wires under there, because as soon as you put your track together and put it all together, that's the best conductivity you're ever going to have. It you know, the joints tend to corrode a little bit over time, and even though you keep the top of the rails nice and shiny, the connection bits, you really can't get to them. So it's worth another, you know, 10 feet of wire and another couple of solder joints.
Yep. And to expand on that, which Alan might address, so I'll let Alan go first.
Now, there's just a quick check. It may sound crazy to a lot of people, but we've used this in the model railroading industry when I was developing DCC systems. And a real quick way to check if you've got an adequate wiring, adequate busing, is what we call the old quarter trick. Turn your power supply on, crank the amps up, put a quarter across the rails. If your power supply trips, your wire is adequate.
If the quarter,
if you go up, down another 5-10 feet, do it again. If it trips, it's adequate in that area.
But if your quarter starts heating up and your power supply doesn't trip, then you've got an issue.
Exactly.
What I was going to say is, you know, depending on the type of track, if you're putting
it together, you fuses there, but...
yeah, probably.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, make sure it's got a good automatic resetting fuse before you do that. But depending on the type of track, and if you're intending to leave that layout up for an extended period of time, then some kind of anti-oxidation treatment to the pin connections is, for me, IMHO, your mileage may vary, is not a bad idea. I prefer to use Inox MX3 because it works for just about every kind of metal-on-metal contact that I've ever done for anything, computers to slot cars. Other people, I've seen people suggest WD-40 or dielectric grease or whatever, but something to help reduce the oxidation over time of those connections.
Yep.
But also make sure they're snug to begin with. You know, and Scalextric track is notorious for having loose connections that just loosen from you know, temperature changes. So when you put them together for the first time or the last time, you know, make sure every one of those connections is nice and snug. It's got your antioxidant on the pins and whatnot. You got your power taps in place. And it should last for a good long time.
Has anybody used aluminum foil for the connections between the?
I've seen that done. I've seen that recommended specifically for Scalextric Sport, but I think that was invented prior to anti-oxidizing agents like Inox MX3, and the realization that the reason it's loose is because the tabs that hold the rails to the plastic have been stretched, and so sticking tinfoil on there is just going to make them stretch even more. Your best bet is to push the tabs down or depending on what kind of track it is, whatever you need to do to make that socket like new, like, you know, snug as it used to be when it was very first manufactured, before you go jamming more metal into that connector. But if there's no way to do that, and the only way to make a good connection is by jamming more metal in there, then yeah, tinfoil will do the job.
What about the copper tape underneath? Throwing everything out there today.
I went the wiring route, like I mentioned earlier. I've got little wire jumpers between every single track in my layout. There's lots of solutions for that. Some people say copper tape over the top. I don't recommend that because you're constantly trying to poke through it or resolder joint. You're basically no better off. In the long run, you're no better off than without the copper tape in the first place and lots of power taps. But looks like Dennis has some wisdom.
Actually, no, Dennis is putting his hand up to ask the question. That is completely different.
All right, anybody else have any wisdom for DeJuan? Wait until they're done. Now's the time to get your point of view out on plastic track longevity tips and tricks.
Yeah. And the short story is I'm right at the final stages of starting to prepare for my massive layouts, different layouts and things like that. And so I've done some of these practices already. I just kind of want to teeter-totter off of everyone's inputs and see where we're going. But I've done
a lot of stuff. You're using Revell track, right, DeJuan?
I'm going to be having a flavor of three different tracks as my current setup, but I'll be doing the Revell track with the Batman. I'm going to do a monogram track, and I'm also going to probably be doing a career digital track.
Okay, well, the monogram and the Revell are essentially the same thing.
Identical, yes.
And they were one of the better tracks in terms of conductivity long-term. The one you, out of the three, the one you want to spend the most time with is the Carrera.
Okay.
And the trick with
Carrera in terms of setting it up.
Yeah.
It's a great track, but it's out of the three that you've mentioned, it is the most error prone in terms of conductivity issues.
Okay.
And all of them are great tracks. Revell's my favorite plastic track of all time.
The kick in the pants with Carrera is that it's stainless steel, not nickel-plated steel. So soldering to it is just a non-starter unless you have the equipment and the experience. So generally, you're just stuffing folded up wire into the opening underneath the track to serve as your power tap, so that it's just making physical contact inside the rail from underneath. Okay. You know, a power tap is a power tap as long as you've got a good, you know, metal on metal pressure connection. No, it's not as good as soldering, but it's better than nothing. All right, Dennis, you got 3 minutes. Go.
I want to ask the guys who run multi-line scale electric sets a question. I have a client or a customer who wants a four-lane scale electric layout, and I'm struggling to find part numbers and or information about how you set up the control units or the power tap section where you plug the controllers in for four lanes. Is there a special one, or do you use two of the regular ones? If you use two of the regular ones, one of them is going to have to be turned around so that otherwise you can't get the tracks next to each other. So do you have to reverse the polarity on that? What do you guys do?
Scalectric sold a piece that connects for just this thing. If you remember the old T2, T3 Scalectric sets that came together, you put the regular connector track on for one and two cars on one, two lanes. And then it gave you that extra piece that ran underneath there. And you put the power on the same side, but the wires, it comes apart, and you put that half on that side, and there's a switch that says, if I find a picture of it again, I'll grab it for you. But thanks. Scale Electric makes this piece, and you can make it, it says it connects like the old Scale Electric style with the new sport style, but it's really a switch to do four lanes. So,
because when I started looking, I get a couple of numbers, but I really don't get anything that tells me, you know, that there's not enough there to say, you know, I see a picture of a piece of track with wires on it. That doesn't tell me anything about how the controllers are connected up.
Right.
Yeah. If I think outside of those, the Trans Am sets that Jeremy's referring to, the T1 and T2 and whatnot, that did they sell that four lane track outside of those sets?
I thought they did. There's a part I've got to put away right now. I've still got some. So if I dig it out, I'll send it in an email to you, Dennis, if I find
the part number on it. Thank you, Jeremy. I would appreciate that.
Sure.
Yeah. Tell this guy to get a set up a regular club.
It's the only time that I've done it in the past. I've basically used a second control unit, turned it around, opened it up underneath, and changed the polarities over so that the four lanes run in the same direction. And then two controllers are plugged in from one side, and two controllers are plugged in from the other side.
Yeah. I mean, if he's wanting an off-the-shelf kind of solution, then you're probably going to have to do that, right? Because I don't think Skelectric make them anymore. So you're either digging up some old stock from somewhere, which obviously Electric Dreams doesn't have, right? or you're jerry-rigging it.
Yeah.
If I find it, I'll give you that part number. And I think I've got several of them because I bought, I think, four sets of the T2 and four sets of the T3.
Yeah, it's 8452 or 8451 or something like that was the last time I saw a number.
All right, we'll let you guys figure that out in the after show. And until
thank you very much.
We'll all wave goodbye. And I'm going to hit the stop button. Bye.